Okay, we're back. So Velvet Underground, Deja Vu. I feel like we just talked about them. I guess it was two episodes ago, I think. And this is their follow-up album to White Light, White Heat, a divisive album on this old podcast here. But this one came out in March of 1969. After White Light, White Heat was released in January of 1968, tensions in the band started to increase. Lou Reed and John Cale wanted to take the band in different artistic directions, and the band as a whole was tired of not getting recognized for their work. I think that's an important point to bring up for Velvet Underground. They actually wanted to be popular, despite their first couple of albums being considered avant-garde and abrasive. So I think that is something to keep in mind when we discuss this album. So we have Cale on one end being very kind of more experimental, and Lou Reed being more traditional and probably wanting to be more popular. Reed had called a meeting at one point without Cale present and said, told the band members that Cale was getting kicked out of the band or the band was going to be dissolved if they didn't agree to it. Cale played his last show with the band in September of 1968, and he was fired shortly after. I couldn't find out what his reaction was to being kicked out of the band. I'm sure there was some hard feelings there, but maybe he wanted to go in a different direction anyway. That would be something I need to look into more.
I think my understanding is that he was not happy about it. I don't think he was looking to go solo, and I think he and Lou Reed had issues for a while afterwards, even though they did reunite, but I don't think he liked that getting
Okay.
kicked out.
Yeah. I mean, it seemed like he had a long career after the fact and has been
Absolutely.
influential with people.
On a totally unrelated note, Josh, are we still on for that meeting after the
Wait, what?
podcast?
Haha, yeah.
Boy, Josh, you really sold that joke right there. You can tell how much we rehearse these things.
The first two albums were released on their jazz label, Verve, which was an imprint of MGM. And so for this album, they moved up to the main MGM label release, which I guess is probably a bigger deal. So out goes Cale, and in comes musician Doug Yule. Yule had known the band, and they had actually stayed at his house when they performed in Boston in 1968. He ended up playing bass for the band as well as organ and contributed vocals. And after several months of shows, they started recording this album in late 1968 in Hollywood, and was released March 1969. So gone are the harsh, more experimental Velvet Underground sound, and there's a new, gentler Velvet Underground in its place. This album is more influenced by folk music and has more personal emotional songwriting by Lou Reed. He is credited as the primary songwriter for a majority of these songs. Another possible but kind of murky reason for the change in sound is the fact that Vox equipment was rumored to be stolen at an airport while they were on tour, and they signed a new deal with Sun Amps. And then Reed and Sterling Morrison both bought matching Fender 12-string electric guitars. Now, I kind of take that with a grain of salt because, I mean, I don't know too much about music equipment, but it seems more like Reed wanted to go in a more populist direction as opposed to their equipment. However, you still have some experimentation on this album. You've got Mo Tucker singing on the last track of After Hours. You've got the murder mystery song where all four are singing vocals at different times, sometimes simultaneously. And there are actually two different mixes to this album. The widely distributed one, which we heard probably most likely on Spotify, was done by the MGM engineer. And then there was one done by Lou Reed himself called dubbed the Closet Mix, which boosts his vocals and guitar solos and brings down the levels on the other instruments. You can actually hear that on the Super Deluxe version that's also on Spotify if you are so inclined. The album did not chart on the Billboard when it was released again, so their failures continue on that front. And so that's all I have really for this album. Let's go to Matt. So after our discussion last time with White Light, White Heat, did you respond to the shift in style in this quote-unquote new Velvet Underground on this album?
Yes, I did. Absolutely. I was a little bit more mixed. I think I was kind of in the middle on the White Light, White Heat album. But this was a much more pleasant listening experience. I liked this from the get-go. I like the more the subdued sound. It's there's there's yeah there's not a ton of, I wouldn't say production on it, but the production is pretty solid. You know, it's pretty crisp. They've certainly done away with the the distortion, the cacophony, the yes. instruments kind of all over the place, and just like, you know, the Bill and Ted guitar playing, as I've kind of dubbed it. You know, just the dudes in the garage just kind of going at it and not really having much structure to it. But there's a lot of structure here. Beautiful melodies. I guess I never realized like how good of a gift that Lou Reed had for melody, you know? So I really, you know, was drawn to some things. I did know some of the songs on here. I did Pale Blue Eyes. I had heard before. And yep. I'm pretty sure I had heard After Hours before and never really knew if I equated that was a Velvet Underground song, but there was something familiar about it. Mm-hmm. But maybe it's just because sounds like something that like Zooey Deschanel did, you know, or one of those White Stripes songs where they have Meg White saying, you know, kind of at the end or whatever. Yep. Which is another takeaway I got from this. This album could have come out yesterday, as far, you know, some indie rock band or whatever. This sounds very modern, mm-hmm. and the idea that this came out in the late '60s is just, you know, I don't know if there was much out there that sounded quite like this. Overall, very good. It's not all downbeat. It's not all like sullen, sad kind of, you know, melancholy type sounds. You've got songs like What Goes On and Beginning to See the Light. They're upbeat. It's catchy stuff you can dance to. Just an overall great listen. And I liked it right away. Mm-hmm. And I listened to it several times. It's a good album to listen to at night or in the morning. It's like a good entry to the day or a close to the day. The only thing, I mean, the murder mystery certainly stands out here, being the, you know, almost 9 minutes long. That to me, as soon as that guitar kicked in, I thought I was listening to Sonic Youth. I mean, that just sounded like something. Mm-hmm. It's like mm-hmm. exactly what Sonic Youth was doing, at least with the guitar sound. I hesitate to call that much of a song. It's just experimental. I wouldn't say as much as what we heard with some of the White Light, White Heat stuff. And, you know, it's just a lot of talking in the background over one another. It's just, I don't know. It didn't really do a whole lot for me. And by the end of the week, I found myself kind of just skipping over that, going, yeah, I don't really.
Yeah.
It stands out as, you know, I don't know, maybe they're trying to hang on to some of their experimentation or just doing something different, trying to scratch that itch. I just don't think it really worked for me here. I actually probably liked more of the experimental stuff on White Light, White Heat, probably better than the murder mystery here. But other than that, I thought it was great. I'm sure the lyrics were great, but I didn't really pay a whole lot of attention to that, so I'll leave that up to you guys. But I thoroughly enjoyed this, much better than a much better experience listening to this than White Light, White Heat.
All right. It's positive for Matt. What about you, John? What do you think?
I would call this album inoffensive, would be the best way to describe it, which is kind of funny mm-hmm. because it's the first album. I wouldn't say it was offensive, but it was not an easy listen and certainly not anything I wanted to go back to. This album definitely sounds as if they were serious now about actually becoming popular, as opposed to just theoretically saying they were, but making experimental music. Mm-hmm. It's interesting that Matt would compare the murder mystery to Sonic Youth. I see what he's going for there. It might sound like early Sonic Youth, but you know, by the time Sonic Youth was putting out like Daydream Nation, they tightened up that feel quite a bit. But I do know what he was going for on that, because it is a little bit of a sprawling guitar feedbacky paradise along the way. There are some really good songs on here. Candy Says and Pale Blue Eyes really stand out to me as being the two best songs on the track. I think the word I would use for this album is atmospheric. Matt said it's a good album to listen to at night, and I know what he's going for, because it has a little bit of a mood setting tone to it. Mm-hmm. I wouldn't necessarily call it background music for a scene, but it does have that feel a little bit, where it's almost like scoring a certain type of evening or a certain type of mood, I guess. If the White Light, White Heat was designed to make you uncomfortable and uneasy, this is sort of the opposite of that. It's designed to let you sink in a little bit and sort of flow over you a little bit and almost relax you. I wonder if that was intentional, because it really does seem like the tranquilizer after the bad trip that was White Light, White Heat. But definitely liked it better than White Light, White Heat, both in terms of my sonic palette, and the experimentation of the earlier album was tough for me. I like challenging music, but that was a little bit challenging at, you know, at the discordant area. And that's why it's so funny that I would say this album's inoffensive, because I think it almost goes the opposite way, where there isn't a whole lot of edge to this album. And it's just very funny that you had an album that was all edge followed immediately by this, which is sort of lacking edge. And that's kind of my take. I wouldn't necessarily recommend it, but it certainly is not, it's not going to be something that's difficult to listen to either.
Yeah, that was my reaction too. I was like, where is the edge on this album? I can't imagine. I can't think of another band that we've talked about that has such a stark departure from their previous album to the next. Especially once
Captain
we talk
Beefheart.
About. Okay, well, yes, that's valid. But in terms of kind of staying in the same genre, almost. This is, if you heard this album first and then went back and listened to some, if you had not heard of Velvet Underground before and heard this and then heard their previous albums, you would not recognize the band. It's, I think a little something is missing when they don't have the edge anymore. I kind of missed the craziness of White Light, White Heat and the first album as well when we talk about that. But there are some good songs here. I think a lot of these songs have been covered by other artists at various points of times and on shows. And I felt the same way Matt did about After Hours. I think I've heard that. I mean, I think I've heard it by Velvet Underground, but it seems like any person with a ukulele on YouTube's probably covered this song or something. It's a nice hearing Mo Tucker sing as well. Some of these songs are very catchy. I feel like, speaking to the lyrics that Matt talked about, I feel like there is a more introspective Lou Reed on this album, or at least it came through this time as opposed through all the cutting through all the noise on the previous album. But yeah, like John said, there's no mention of drugs on this. There's no sex like there was on White Light, White Heat. It's all very unoffensive, as John said. You've got some questioning of religion and or you know, place, identity and place in the world, and about love and a relationship where one of the partners ends up loving someone else. And then you've got Candy Says, which is a classic song about a transgender person not wanting to, or not identifying with their body and their identity. So again, back to that identity piece. So there's definitely something that Lou Reed was working on or trying to tackle with a lot of those themes. I think the album overall as a whole was successful, and I enjoyed listening to it, but I kept hoping for some sort of, bring back a little bit of the abrasiveness would be my response.
I probably would have liked some of that too. But I think that, again, I like the mixture of both. I think is really great when you have it. But at the same time, I didn't really think of that till we're just talking about it now. That's like, yes, of course it's got no edge, but I didn't find myself wanting that. I kind of, I saw this more as an intentional, type of sound that they were going for that was very different than before. Maybe I don't know, Cale probably is more of the adventurous, you know, avant-garde musician, and Reed was more trying to do the, so this is almost maybe, since he was maybe mad at Cale, this was clearly an intentional, we're going to do something totally different that's not going to sound like anything that John Cale did, because we're going to not just kick him out of the band, but we're going to leave no trace behind, you know, that's just the way it is. So, but I didn't find myself wanting, or you know, being like, oh man, I really wish they were doing this. I kind of just accepted it as an overall piece, again, except for the murder mystery. But I'm not really, you know, kind of including that in my overall, you know, analysis. But I liked what they were doing here. I thought that they did it well. And sometimes albums can just be like that, right? That you can have an artist that's capable. Like Wilco's a great example of that, because they're a band that can kind of go very somber, very slow, very kind of chill, and then they can do this really weird kind of like very experimental type thing. I think if you do that other stuff really well, like that, you know, the mellow stuff pretty well, I can live without the, you know, I can get my experimentation and edge elsewhere. So I was totally okay with that.
I think overall it's a success. It's a success, and it's clear that Lou Reed, it shows what the direction the band is without Cale, and that like he just brings such a defining presence, or clearly, you know, brought all that experimentation. And then when you remove that piece of the puzzle, it just sounds like a completely different band, which is valid.
Well, Warhol's gone too, so a lot of the provocateur element seems like it's gone from this album, and I think it's much more of a musical statement maybe than an art statement. I always have thought of the Velvet Underground, especially early in their career, being as much a art project as a band. I think that's kind of what the appeal is for them. But I'm also familiar with Lou Reed's stuff in the 70s in particular, and that is definitely, he's making albums, you know, he's not making art house projects. There's a little bit of the art house element here in terms of the lyrical content, like Josh mentioned. It is, especially for, you know, the late 1960s, very transgressive and ahead of its time in terms of lyrical content and subjects covered, just the stuff you didn't really hear. But I guess living in, you know, New York City at that time, you know, you did get a different spin than almost anywhere else in the world. But this is definitely an album that was made to make music as opposed to make an artistic statement. And I know we haven't done the initial Velvet Underground album yet, which will be an interesting review, but definitely the second album felt like they said before, like a conceptual piece talking about sort of chaos in the world and the discordant nature of it. It's chaotic. It talks about a lot of society's underbelly. It's got like a dark sense of humor if you take it that way, but it also can seem bleak if you take it another way. I think this is the first time we're getting to see the band in terms of viewing them primarily in their musical merits.
Yes, it's a much more musical album. That's a good way to think of it.
Wasn't Warhol gone with the? He was only there for the first album, right? I mean, he wasn't his influence still there? Wasn't it really there for the second album? That was probably just more of them themselves, or maybe more Cale, if he was the more avant-garde guy. Maybe that was more his influence.
Yeah, Warhol was gone by White Light, White Heat, but I think his effects probably linger, and also maybe just Cale's involvement as well.
Yeah, I don't know if it was only Cale though who was avant-garde. I think all of them were avant-garde. I just think that they changed gears, you know, in terms of what they wanted to sound like. And my guess would be that they wanted to make some money because it definitely is a more streamlined album than the first two.
They made you, I think, John, you had an interesting take last time with White Light, White Heat, saying that they did, it's almost like they didn't care about the listener, you know, with what they put out, that they didn't care about liking it.
They were making it from a standpoint of, you know, being an addict, you know what I mean? Almost all of them. And it was, you know, it was about those themes. And so, you know, I don't know the sobriety status of the rest of the group at this point, but this reads as a much more sober album, doesn't it, in many ways?
Yes, for sure.
Contemplative, you know, atmospheric. These are things that you don't often... Well, I guess I shouldn't say you don't often do with musicians who are in the throes of substance abuse, because definitely, you know, jazz would counter that right off the bat. There's plenty of contemplative stuff after. But a lot of times when artists become this level of introspective, a lot of times it's after personal crisis or tumult and stuff like that. And a lot of times that is, you know, coming out of a rough period of life that often includes addiction.
Yeah. Well, and it, go ahead, Josh.
Just like Lou Reed said, beginning to see the light, right? He's coming out of the hole that maybe what White Light, White Heat represents in terms of, you know, dark themes, topics, and feelings, and this is a bit more lighthearted.
Well, musically, it's happier. You know, I mean, when you've got something like Beginning to See the Light, What Goes On, After Hours, that's kind of like a happy, it's just like kind of like an old-timey, you know, bouncy type song. So, you know, musically, it's not everything, obviously, because some of it's a very, you know, a little bit melancholy, but there's some songs on here that I would characterize as being happy, you know, danceable, catchy.
Yeah, definitely.
But yeah, okay. I'd say listen to this. I'm a big fan. Maybe I like it more than you guys. But I like this from the get go, and it's certainly an interesting contrast to the previous one. And I probably know some of the stuff on the first album, but I'm excited to cover it because I really don't know a whole lot about it. But I know that's the big one. That's the one that everybody talks about. So
yep.
We'll be doing that soon.
It'll be a nice counterpoint to this. We'll see where everything started.
All right.